Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sorry I had to speak in English, but understand that Finnish is not necessarily the easiest language in the world to learn. In God, we blindly trust, but beware big data. By the way, it's being videoed, and it'll be up on my YouTube channel probably tomorrow with a little bit of luck. And I'll let the guys here know where the link is so you can get at it. And you'll be able to find the presentation of it at that link there. You'll find the slides in note form, so that you see lots of pictures, which are the slides I'm showing, and then some notes and thoughts, which will help you to remember what this is all about. So you don't really need to take photos unless you want to, but hey, why not? Just a word of warning, please, ladies and gentlemen. What you're going to hear is seriously provocative. It could sound exceptionally cynical. It's based on 30 plus years, 40 years in the industry. And it's actually a dose of serious skepticism, which means think about the evidence, think about the reality of real humans, not just those like us, but everybody else. We are all very different. And we see an amazing amount of hype about big data, the IoT, analytics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, cognitive computing. Apply a skeptical test of reality, folks. This is what all this session is about. Little outline. I want to first of all look at what is leadership, what is management. Well, I guess all of you are leaders. At least I hope you are. I'm going to take you through a story, a journey that will help, I hope, to help you to develop a very powerful form of leadership in the field of analytics, big data, the IoT, and all the other things that we're looking at in this conference today. I want to cover a little bit about ethics. I want to look at success of IT-related projects. A critical question today is the veracity of the data that we are using in all of our systems. We collect data from everywhere. We have our corporate systems, we have our social media inputs, we have stuff coming out of our ears from IoT sensors and so on. But how much can we actually trust that data to give us good answers? We'll have a brief look at some aspects of machine learning and cognitive computing, the new thing in the future, well, the thing that's here. But how can we use it to obtain business value for ourselves as organizations? How can we deliver value to all of the stakeholders and our customers? I will then point you to the appendix, because we won't have time to go through the 12 V's of big data and big data governance. A set of 12 V's are words beginning with V that help you to ask very, very searching questions about your projects, about the source, the type, the nature of the data, so that you can begin to think through much more clearly than we have in the past. I've been involved in IT projects since 1973, when I left university and started as a junior trainee systems analyst. I've seen quite a lot. I've helped implement ERP systems. I've led the development of one of the largest project management systems in the world in the mid-80s using SAS. So I've seen successes, I've seen failures. I hope from all of that you might be able to learn a little. Do you manage from behind? Do you lead from the front? Which is easier for you? We all have different natures. Some of us are much happier managing, organising things, allocating resources, just getting the job organised and done. But I think the fun part is the leadership out there, in the front. But part of what's the role there, here's five questions, five ideas that are probably very, very important, but are they all that are necessary? Yes, a vision is clearly a really great idea. It helps to set out the direction. It's kind of like the concept that we use in management of strategy. The direction that we're trying to go. The place we want to end up when we've finished leading. We need to be passionate about our ideas, about our vision. We need to develop that inspiration in those around us. You see, the difference between a manager and a leader is a lot of managers like to have clones of themselves around them. It makes it so easy to communicate. It's easier because you won't get that critical thinking that suggests that maybe that bright idea is not necessarily the best idea that is around. But if you are a leader, then you may well and should be open to diverse perspectives, different ideas. Allow your support teams, those beneath you, those above you, to challenge what you are suggesting, to challenge your vision so that the vision can be improved. If you look at what is happening in many countries, in many businesses, I see it now developing in the UK and in the USA. In the Prime Minister and the President. I have the ideas, you will implement them. I saw that back in the 90s with many of the business process re-engineering projects and ERP implementations around the country. I have the idea, I'm the board member sponsoring the project. Please do not tell me any of the reasons why you think it won't work. Just go and implement my vision. It doesn't work. It causes chaos. You need to have a diverse team around you to help you and the team improve your ideas. Too many managers, however, go the other way. I want a team who will just implement what I have said. Walking the talk. If, as a leader or a manager, senior exec, you say one thing and then do the other, the staff below you, the teams below you, will very, very quickly rumble that and understand. But you don't believe in what you've just said. Your team will fall apart. You have to have exquisite communication skills. To do that, you need to understand those around you. You need to understand their world models as well as your own world models. There was a politician in Britain a few years ago who was very passionate about an idea that he had. And he said words about what his idea was about. And then he was horrified to discover that nobody believed it. So he said, it's their problem. They didn't understand what I was trying to get at. My communication was clear to me, and clearly they're too stupid to understand me. But a politician should be a person who understands communication above all, and should have realised that as a communicator, the responsibility for telling the story in the terms that the audience understands is a communicator. It's my problem if you don't understand what I'm saying, not yours. As a leader, if your teams aren't inspired by you, maybe you need to think about how you're communicating and choosing your words, your ideas, your concepts in words that they associate with. That's part of what the art of storytelling is. I should come back to storytelling in the field of analytics in a little while. And yes, you do need courage because the world is often against you, as Il Principe pointed out. There are always a few out there leading, but the people who are really going to be vocal are those who are against the change. Niccolo Machiavelli. But is that all that's necessary? Those five items there. Now the interesting thing is that I wouldn't be here if I hadn't worked for a couple of amazing leaders. The head of department and the dean of the college. A lot of academics are at the senior level, kind of managerial, because there's a pressure on them. The two guys who were above me are really great leaders. And they inspire, and they empower those who are receptive to that message. In many parts of academia, you have to ask for permission to do things. You have to ask for permission to change the way that you want to handle your teaching and the learning of your students. Now, about 3 years ago, I was encouraged to change my approach incredibly dramatically. I'd started in the University of Derby in 2002, having had a 30-odd year career at Rolls-Royce Aerospace. And there are lots of things I've been passionate about, including things like IT law and governance. And like most of my colleagues, I felt that the thing that's important for the students was to get stuff out of here into their heads, because, hey, it was really interesting, it was really cool, but incredibly important. But it kind of didn't work very well. And I kind of understood, but didn't understand, a colleague who said, lectures, Richard, don't work at all. It goes in one ear, and 99.5% comes out the other ear before it's even been sort of finished the lecture. And so I sort of introduced a bit of question and answer. I started introducing a few ideas like reviews of the students' assignments with them, which most of my colleagues thought was bonkers, but it takes a lot of time. And then 3 years ago, these two guys kind of helped me. I changed from an academic as domain expert with all this knowledge to transfer into our students' brains. And I changed to something quite different. Academic, as learning mentor and guide. Other than in the first year, I very rarely will give much of an introduction to a seminar. Depends a little bit on the circumstances and how much access the students have to online resources during the sessions so they can do research. I switch them to learning by research. I give them a little bit of a context, the week. I identify essentially three critical questions that they need to go and research and find out. Maybe definitions, it may be whatever is necessary. And then, in the rest of the seminar and the workshop, they then start thinking about how to apply that idea, or those ideas, into their developing assignment. I spend most of my time working one-to-one with the students. Almost no other colleagues do that. But the results that are result from the whole process now deliver some of the highest level grade averages in the whole university sector, certainly in the university. There are one or two other colleagues who use similar style and they're doing the same sort of level. What is also fascinating is that instead of having bimodal distributions, UK, Caucasian, everybody else, black minority, ethnic and so on, 20 points lower, I have a single unimodal distribution. All of the students, whether they're black, white, Asian, international students, are on a single monomodal distribution. Grade averages, 75% typically. And that's because I was allowed to develop this incredibly different approach, which I'm now trying to get other students, other colleagues, to start using. But so change, a huge change to my academic approach, plus this empowerment to get involved outside of the university. I developed my web-based presence at the computing.derby.ac website, which is our kind of parallel environment for the college. And started posting up there copies of all of my presentations at academic sort of conferences and one or two businessy sort of conferences. And within 6 to 8 months, I was getting messages, partly because I then cloned that into LinkedIn. I was getting messages from now 6 or 7 different conference organisers, including, of course, management events. Please, Richard, we'd kind of like to have you. And now, I'm helping to develop agenda at other conferences, not here, but some of the other conferences that I'm involved with. All because my two seniors inspired and encouraged me. Now here I am, technically at the end of my career. I could have retired a few months ago. And I'm having the greatest fun I've ever had. Seeing places that I've never been before. Maybe helping you to better things. Just because I had an inspiring and empowering leader. So that's my little journey that puts me here on the stage in front of you guys. Now, how does all that relate to what we are doing here? Well, let us start with the UK Companies Act 2006, section 172. This is a list in law of responsibilities of corporate directors. Number one, to have consideration for the sustainability of the organisation. Not short term, but long term. Number two, and this has very interesting consequences in some of what we're doing in the IT world today, to bear in mind the interests of a company's employees. And then various other ones. Now, if you are going to be sustainable, you don't need to follow the stuff on the left, on the left-hand side of these curves. Who's seen the Gartner hype curves before? Quite a lot. I tripped over this one for a lecture I was giving, well, not a lecture, a seminar for one of my courses last week. This beautiful side-by-side comparison of 2013, 14, 15 and 16. The lesson from this one is an awful lot of the stuff on the left-hand side of the picture, climbing up. The stuff that is everybody's talking about at big analytics conferences kind of stays there for a year, 2 years, and then evaporates without trace. Now, I'm not saying we should not look at that stuff to evaluate it, to see what the possibilities are. But perhaps as a small-scale experiment, see what its value might be. You see, if you go back to the early 2000s, when RFID chips were busy crawling their way up to the left-hand side, Walmart was one of the companies that really tipped it over into the real active use. Walmart's an interesting company. They have had, ever since Sam Walmart set the company up back in the 60s, have had an overarching corporate strategy to become or to be the most cost-effective supermarket in the world. That has not changed in the best part of 40 or 50 years, however long Walmart have been there. One of the most enduring strategic statements of any company that I know of the last 50, 60 years. And they still haven't changed it. And what they were doing, as you can read in Nicholas Carr's book, IT Doesn't Matter, what they were doing when they triggered the activity with what RFID chips was to be able to flood them into the market across their entire supply chain without Walmart funding it at all. They just got their suppliers to do it. And that drove the cost of RFID chips down from $1, $2, $3 a chip to 1 or 2 cents a chip. They looked at it very, very carefully, got their supply chain to evaluate it, the supply chain's cost, and they kind of developed what was going to be effective. But if you look at the left-hand side of some of these, you're not going to read it on here, you'll have to go find on wherever your search engine is, the images of the Gartner hype cycle, you're going to find all of these individually there, and you're going to read them. Read them carefully, please. So that's, don't jump on the bandwagon because other people are saying jump. Think carefully. The second one is a bit about ethics. There are a couple of professors in Frankfurt University who've come up with the Data for Humanity principles. You could say these are the updated version of Asimov's three laws of robotics. Do no harm. You can read the rest. I'll come back to the do no harm one in a few minutes. The third critical issue is the, as I mentioned on the introduction, project success. Or rather, the staggering lack of success of IT and analytics for the last 23 years. Standish Group first reported this in 1994, based on surveys of chief information officers or IT directors around the world. They do the chaos survey every year. The blue and the purple are those projects which are successful, defined originally, the blue line, on time to budget, delivering the contracted for functionality. The red line, that was the outright failures. And then the blue, green, And the pale blue at the top are the, what they call the challenge projects, laying over budget and delivering only part of the contracted for functionality. And they, the challenge projects, are typically 40% late, 40% over budget, and more critically, delivered only about 40% of the contracted for functionality. Which, as many of you who've been involved in the industry as long as I have, will remember that by about the 90s, we were Pareto principling the customers' requirements and delivering only about 20% of the functionality that they required, but covered 80% of the activity. And the rest, well, we'll get rid of it. So you deliver 40% of 20% equals 8% of the necessary functionality to carry out the business of the department or the organization. That has consequences. Now you'll see that the success line changes in 2011, because many IT directors, CIOs, were complaining to Standish Group about, well, look, in this day and age, you know, the functionality that we wanted at the beginning of a project is going to change, because time goes on, the world won't stop, and we need to respond. So we have to morph and develop the projects. What we would like, they said, was on time, to budget, and delivers business value, thinking that that would increase the rates of success. They introduced that in 2013 with a back survey for the preceding 2 years to recalibrate. As you can see, there's something like 8 or 10% drop. Now that is an interesting observation. But substituting delivering the contracted for functionality with delivering benefit, business benefit, reduces the number of projects which are then categorized as successful. It suggests that what many of us have known for many, many years is that even projects that are delivered on time to budget and so on and so forth actually don't deliver an awful lot of business benefit. A lot of IT is in place because, well, if you're in banking, you can't exist without IT. IT is actually the cost of doing business. It may not deliver any value. So here's an interesting problem. Consequent on this, various people have then started looking at, okay, if IT is not so successful and only 30-something percent of projects are successful and the rest are challenged or fail, what are the cost consequences of that? So you've got the cost of the projects that don't succeed, i.e. the actual build cost, the implementation cost, and collapse. You've got the challenge ones which go in place with some of the functionality, but everybody using had to do all sorts of workarounds which actually use an awful lot of cost and time. Right? Online expenses booking for your overseas trips. I used to be able to do, at the university this is, fill out a piece of paper with the basic expenses. I mean, it could be the hotel for 3 days with the meals added in, one item. One transaction to be translated from dollars to sterling. Hand it in, and somebody in there which will fit it in somehow. Today, we now have these lovely things like SAP and Oracle and PeopleSoft. And you then have to, because of company organizational rules, every single line item now has to be broken out. You know, think about your hotel bill and your meals. Typically, at least two, maybe lunch, breakfast and dinner in there. Each of those have to be broken out as single line items. An hour and a half later, I've done it. That's serious productivity improvement, isn't it, folks? That's why we have the so-called productivity paradox. Some of the estimates are really rather scary about the cost consequences of that curve, or those curves. Start off with the failures of security that we've seen over the last few years. Ever increasing number of hacks and numbers of IDs being stolen. Last year, around about 1 billion sets of ID were stolen. The accepted wisdom, the accepted cost is about $200 per set. So that says the economic cost of just that, those failures of security is around about $200 billion a year. For the in the UK, for TalkTalk, mobile phone and ISP company, their costs were something like £400 sterling per ID that was stolen in the event last year. They lost, or it hit them by about £60 million. That lost business, people moving away, etc., etc. And that wasn't the consequential cost necessarily to the affected clients or customers. I'm not going to translate that into billion either. We spend $3 trillion roughly a year on ICT, 5% of world GDP. At the far end, which is probably overcooking the numbers a bit, but takes account of all the consequential additional costs of the software not being as good as it could be, or as flexible, or meeting the user's needs and so on, up to $6 trillion, 10% of world GDP. Take a pick in between half a trillion and 6 trillion. The point is not cynicism, but it's skepticism. What are we doing with our corporate money? How are we really, as leaders, ensuring we get real value for our money? Why is it that if you look around the sort of post-implementation audits, they are never, ever published? We never learn from each other. This is what the first chaos report pointed out. We are unsuccessful like this because we never dare tell the public why our projects have failed. Because our shareholders would get seriously upset, our share price would go down. The only reports you can get about some of these failures are from the government agencies. In the UK, the Public Affairs Accounts Committee sometimes has reports of public systems, successes and failures. There are some successes and there are some failures. But at least in those reports, you can begin to see what's really going on. But as businesses, none of us share very often what the real fundamental causes might have been. We don't learn. We can't learn. And it's the can't learn that's really a problem. Another aspect that causes all those projects to fail is something this really interesting guy, Daniel Kahneman, has written about in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow. Who has read his book? It's a great book, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's an amazing insight into how we are incredibly optimistic. Planning fallacy, cognitive bias, optimism bias. How many of you have had projects from above? You will do this project in this time scale for this set of resources, and this is what it's going to be. Oh, by the way, I know it's a challenging project. That ring bells? An awful lot of head nodding. I remember one project where we were asked to do a little tiny development project. And I went across to see a couple of my colleagues in the sort of computing organization. We sort of scratched our heads with, we've got the classic back of envelope design, 6 boxes. Enough to tell us what we were doing. And we sort of scratched our heads and said, yeah, we've been through this loop. It's about 12 man years of work. Ah, says them up there. We can afford 3 man years of work. Oh, and to compensate, we'll make sure that the users The expert here is going to contribute. We'll put in 3 man-years as well. So 12 man-years, 6 man-years. Well, actually 3 man-years because the other 3 man-years didn't turn up. Been through that one?
Yeah.
Actually, that one just about squeaked through. It did something. But every project that I know of or that I've ever seen, other than the one that I've run, was, well, you're going to be successful. Why? Now, all the others weren't terribly successful. What are we going to do differently from last time and the time before? And they thought that an arm comes back at you. Do we fully understand, or do those who are sponsoring the projects with this level of optimism, do they really understand what the real likelihood of success is? And in Daniel Kahneman's book, it's really fascinating. While he and his colleagues were still in Israel as academic psychologists, they decided that they were going to create a new course. And they kind of sort of scratched their heads and came up with a time scale. And then they discovered that they were actually on the same trajectory as almost every other project like this, which was, it wasn't going to be done in X years, it was going to be done in kind of 2X years. Which led to the idea of reference class forecasting. Take what we know worldwide, or within the company, or the group of companies, or the industry, and the types of projects, and their actual real live success rates. And for project success in IT and analytics, just use the Standish Group data. It's a superb reference class. Tells you what the real rates of success are. Why are you going to be one of those 30%? What do you need to do to become one of the 30%? That's a really critical question as a leadership role in IT analytics. What is it we should not be doing to be successful? Another thing that Gary Klein has come up with, which is kind of carry out a post-mortem before you actually go live. So you pretend that the project has failed catastrophically, and then as a project team, you try and identify all the possible causes and reasons for why the project failed. Read more about it with Gary Klein's 2 links there. They are an eye-opener. The things that often you don't really want to think about. But when you do, it's incredibly liberating because you suddenly have the evidence as need to do something different. I need to put in place something to avoid that problem. There's another aspect about human behavior that comes out of some of Daniel Kahneman's work as a psychologist before he got his Nobel Prize for economics. We have a very, very asymmetric response to gains and losses. There's a whole lot of stuff that Daniel Kahneman writes in his book about this. But the interesting thing is that we are more likely to lock in benefit quickly rather than play the odds for gains. But for risks and losses, We are very, very prone to playing the odds. It won't happen to me. It won't happen to us. We will be lucky this time. Because we don't always want to put in place the mitigating factors because they're expensive and we might not need them. But it doesn't always work. Now, on to analytics. All of that big data, that enormous amount of data out there. The veracity problem, one of the original five V's of big data. As John Easton pointed out back in 2012, 80% of the data that we are trying to use is of uncertain veracity. Not that it's wrong, it's just that we don't know which data is right or wrong. Or if it is wrong, by how much it is wrong. And that is becoming a critical problem or critical issue for all of us here involved in analytics. When I first saw that, I looked at the bottom bit, there's a bit that says enterprise data. I thought, oh, that enterprise data, that's okay. You know, the stuff that's in our ERP systems must be right. And then I discovered that, yes, and we had been through the exercise just before I left Rolls-Royce, of cleaning up all of our old systems data, filtering it out, cleaning it up, losing or throwing away 60-70% of the old data before we transfer the clean data into SAP. And I thought, well, we've now got clean data. But then I discovered that companies who do that sort of activity within 5 to 10 years are having to carry out the same sort of data cleansing exercises on that new data. It's somehow got dirty in those 8 to 10 years. So we don't necessarily know which of the data, even in our corporate ERP databases, is actually true. Kind of interesting worry. Then you have sensors, and you've got the Internet of Things, you've got social media, and all of these things, providing lots of data that we're trying to use. Sentiment analysis of, you know, click-throughs on marketing and adverts and so on and so forth. So I started getting kind of interested in this one about 3 years ago. Oh, sorry, just to finish off on that one. Even these little gadgets are kind of interestingly inaccurate. I just lent this Vivo Smart HR by one of my daughters, and they are magically inaccurate. Seriously so. Comparing between that thing and my iPhone, which is supposed to be able to count the same number of steps even, there's about a 50% difference between them. And they come preset with different stride lengths, so the amount of mileage I walk a day is kind of, well, it's doubled and then 50% extra. So it's, off this, it's kind of ridiculous amount of miles every day. Sleep algorithms, well, the left-hand one, I was just sitting on the settee watching TV, having my supper, and it thought I was asleep. Mind you, by the time I then did go to sleep a bit later on, the right-hand one, it kind of wiped out that first one, because it kind of worked out that I'd been walking around doing things. However, there are some very, very important consequences. We can have our mirth, we can laugh about it, but the consequences are very, very interesting. If it's just, oh, interesting, okay. Doesn't really matter whether it's 10 or 15% an error. And there's a guy in Paris who does a lot of comparative work. And basically, if you take any set of fitness trackers, activity trackers, yeah, it's about 30% between the lowest and the highest readings all the time. The trouble is when you start doing things with that data. Somewhat inconsequential in principle is the bottom picture. The trouble is, people are relying on the calorific count that comes off them. And yeah, after a few days, let's say, I don't know, 2,500 calories a day, they have one day where their activity level seems to be 3,500 calories a day expenditure. Wow, I can have a blowout today. I can have that extra whatever. And we see people wearing these and relying on them completely are actually putting on weight. They're not getting fitter, they're not getting slimmer, they're putting on weight because they're misusing the data. That's kind of okay, perhaps. Then comes the killer. Insurance companies have jumped on the bandwagon now. You wear this X, and if you meet the activity, calorie, etc. targets that we'll set you with this, we will give you a discount. $500 is happening in one insurance company in the USA. In the UK, there's another one doing that. The sting in the tail is if you don't meet those targets, and the British one says there's a £12 a week penalty that you will hand over at the end of the week if you do not meet your activity targets. Oh, well, nappies, I'll use my Garmin one here because it doubles the number of miles I walk a day. I won't use my iPhone-based one. But whilst that benefits me, if you are the insurance company, I'm taking you for a ride. You won't get the penalty payments you actually are due. And then there's a health plan for dogs. It's just been recently announced. And the tracker, or the particular one that was mentioned, was a golden retriever. 80 minutes of exercise a day required. After an hour's worth of walking the dog around the local nature reserve, it had managed to measure 5 minutes out of the 60 minutes that had actually transpired. So the question we have there about veracity is critical if you are in the insurance industry and you're thinking of developing products that rely on these, which are 30% inaccurate, perhaps. Where are your business ethics folks, perhaps? I'll skip through the location surveys because we're getting towards the end of my set time. But I discovered that location services, the assisted GPS services you have on your smartphones, is also not terribly accurate. And the most interesting one, is the one there. Took four photos in a nice little restaurant somewhere. The first of them was 22 kilometers in error. The next four were kind of within 150 meters of where it should have been. I'm sure many of you have noticed that your location tag photos aren't terribly accurately placed. I mean, at home, if I'm in my sitting room, I am never in my sitting room, according to this, or my GPS trackers. I'm the other side of the road and three doors up. But the consequences for business are kind of interesting. Think near an American company that's surveying billions of ads. Has discovered that 14, and they do this, you can see the different points along the curve, the different quarterly reports. 14%, roughly, of adverts that are sent out to people based on the presumed location, sent out to here, are over 100 kilometers misplaced. Now that raises an interesting vulnerability for you if you're sending out those adverts, location-based adverts. I mean, what's our response if we get an advert for Helsinki? Assuming we're in Helsinki, if we're in Stockholm or somewhere 50 miles away from here. We're not very happy, are we? You get a reputational hit. So these things actually have significant consequences. Almost nobody is actually working on this. So what are you going to do about the veracity problem with the data that you have around you? If you're doing sentiment analysis, you know, positive and negative ratings on TripAdvisor, if we're not careful, we assume that we've got all the information we need on TripAdvisor because everybody posts there. The reality is there's 10 or 100 times as many posting adverse comments about almost everything on those rating sites as rate positively. The reason? Human nature. We've known for 30, 40 years in marketing that if I have a good experience, I might tell three people. If I have a bad experience, at least 10 people will be told about the bad experience. Just think about it. Now, take some little experience you have and think as you go through the day, how many have you told that it's a great experience, or good experience even? Or it's a bad experience. How many people did you really get onto? Even if you didn't go onto the rating sites, how many did you tell about the bad experience? And it skewed hugely. A couple of little items that I just came across the last couple of days. Two projects which over the last 4 years have been big. You know, 3D TVs and curved screens. These lovely big curved screens that give a most amazing immersive experience. 3D TVs have dropped out of the system today, by today. The curved screen, only one new one at CES 2017 in Vegas 2 weeks ago. How many have seen a 3D film in a cinema? Pretty good experience, isn't it? Or can be, if you kind of don't mind these glasses on. Immersive, because this angle it subtends is kind of out like that. Big, wide, you're inside it. Even at home, the biggest screen you could have that covers the whole of the end wall, if you've got a 12-foot square room, is kind of like that. You were looking into this 3D little box. It's predictable if you think about human behavior, human perception. Curved screen, that picture on the left, on the right, shows why the curved screen has died. Because it is designed to focus the light on a single sitting point. Now, most of us have a family with us. And you can't stack the whole family in one sitting point, can you? Both of those projects could, with critical analysis of the design principles, have avoided the hundreds of millions that were invested in those projects with very little ultimate return. So, critical analysis could help you to avoid choosing the projects which are bound to fail. Are there questions that we should not ask? Who remembers the target predicting pregnancy problem? Yeah. Technically, probably couldn't have been done in Europe because of the data protection regime. But more importantly, the question is, are there actually questions we should not even be asking of our data? Are there questions we should not ethically ask? In the UK, it is not legal, not ethical, but not legal, to ask questions about genetic analysis. The insurance companies are desperate to get hold of that data. Fortunately, it is illegal. But taking account, should we be asking our data about can we predict pregnancy? Or was the problem maybe unethical use of the analyses? I do not have the answer to that question. I think we all have to think about that question, about ethical questions, unethical questions, and link them back to principles for humanity. Going on to machine learning very briefly. Neural network-based machine learning is kind of fun. The only problem is we don't know necessarily what those neural networks have actually learned. And this is a classic one from the sort of times of sort of history. Trying to teach a neural network-based recognition system the difference between enemy and friendly tanks. Do the usual sort of thing of supervised learning, and then give it some tests. It worked nearly perfectly with a training set and the testing set, until someone thought, we'll try some other photos. And it failed catastrophically. Because what the neural networks had actually managed to learn was the difference between the foresty bit and the sandy bit. Now, there's some interesting consequences about that. I mean, that was kind of interesting, probably had very relatively little practical impact. But I'll bet there are many projects we have where not knowing precisely what it has actually learned could have significant consequences. The last item, cognitive computing. This is a level above AI, which is all about trying to behave like humans. And one of the best ones I know of is the Watson cognitive environment. Watson Oncology was the first great success after the Jeopardy game. It's ingested all of the reports on diagnosis and treatment of cancer that you can imagine. And it keeps sucking them in every day. And it provides an amazingly good advisor to the cancer specialists. And those at the moment who are using it understand it is an advisor. Because it has read more articles than they have. The problem is with the trainees. They see their specialist, consultant, surgeon, or their seniors interacting and coming up with, yeah, I think you're probably a good idea. What happens to the next generation of oncology specialists? Are they going to see it as an advisor, or will they allow it to become executive? Because they've seen it being used by their seniors so often that they rely on it. So in that case, why should I build a mental model in my head through hard work when I've got this machine sitting there that will do it? And as we spread cognitive in all sorts, not just Watson cognitive, but all the other cognitive systems out there, what's going to happen to the next generations, as they see these things seem to be right most of the time? They will come to rely on it, irrespective of the contractual terms and conditions and warnings that this is only an advisor. Some of you may have seen this one. But initially, human oversight of every single one of the 134,000 decisions a year. Just imagine how bored those 35 people are going to get. And when you get bored, you don't do good oversight. So, what will you do now, folks? Then, three books you really ought to read if you haven't read them all. Few sources and links. And then the back end is a set of slides on the 12 V's of big data that you can read afterwards. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we don't have now time for any questions. Eli nyt sitten lounaalle. Lähdetään tuosta rappia ylös ja sieltä oikealle, niin päästään vähän aterioimaan. Ja jos on kysyttävää Richardilta, niin hän vielä pitää tämän puheen tässä nyt sitten lounaan jälkeen, että sen jälkeen tulkaa ihmeessä kysymään, jos häneltä on sitten vielä jotain kysyttävää aiheeseen liittyen. Mutta nyt sitten kipin kapin sinne päin.
You can have a chat over lunch if you like.
Yeah, that's what I told them.
All right.